Good morning. Previously, we demonstrated that buoyant force equals the weight of the fluid displaced by an object. Today, we are going to demonstrate a few things about the buoyant force on a steel sphere submerged in water.
Flippin' physics.
Bobby, please read the problem, and Bo, please translate.
A steel sphere has a diameter of 50.7 millimeters and a density of 7,750 kilograms per meter cubed. What buoyant force acts on the steel sphere when it is submerged in the water? The density of water is 1.00 times 10 to the third kilograms per meter cubed.
Our knowns are the diameter, which equals 50.7 millimeters, which we multiply by 1 meter over 1,000 millimeters to get 0.0507 meters. But what we really need is the radius, which is half the diameter, or 0.02535 meters. Let's label the density of steel as the density of the object.
Nice.
Yeah. Which equals 7,750 kilograms per cubic meter. And the density of water, which is the density of the fluid displaced by the object, is 1.00 times 10 to the third kilograms per cubic meter. And buoyant force equals question mark.
Thank you. Billy, please solve the problem.
Absolutely. The steel sphere is submerged in water, so the volume of the object is the same as the volume of the fluid displaced by the object, which is the volume of a sphere, or...
4/3 pi times radius cubed.
Right. And buoyant force equals the weight of the fluid displaced by the object, or the mass of the fluid displaced by the object, times the gravitational field strength. And we know density equals mass divided by volume, so mass equals density times volume. Therefore, buoyant force equals the density of the fluid displaced by the object times the volume of the fluid displaced by the object times the gravitational field strength. We can substitute the equation for the volume of a sphere into that, and then we can substitute in numbers. 1,000 times 4/3 times pi times 0.02535 cubed times 9.81 equals... 0.66941, or roughly 0.669 newtons with 3 sig figs.
Well done, Billy. Now let's take some measurements. Actually, let's start with the steel sphere hanging from a string before we lower it into the water. Bobby, what does the free body diagram of the forces acting on the sphere look like right now?
The force of gravity acts down and the force of tension acts up. That's it.
Right. So when we sum the forces in the y direction, we get the force of tension minus the force of gravity equals the mass of the object times the acceleration of the object in the y direction. Because the sphere is at rest, the acceleration is zero, and the force of tension equals the force of gravity. Now, this is the initial position of the steel sphere before I lower it into the water, so let's identify this as the initial tension in the string. Bo, please do what Bobby and I just did for after I lower the sphere into the water.
Sure. After you lower the sphere into the water, the only change in the forces in the free body diagram is that there is now a buoyant force acting up on the sphere. That means the net force in the y direction equals the force of tension. Actually, let's call that force of tension final. Plus the buoyant force minus the force of gravity equals the mass of the object times acceleration in the y direction. Again, that equals zero. And now the force of tension final equals the force of gravity minus the buoyant force. Oh, and we need to decrease the length of the force of tension in the free body diagram. The force of tension final is less than the force of tension initial. Actually, the amount it is decreased by is equal to the value of the buoyant force. Because the length of the force of tension final arrow plus the length of the buoyant force arrow equals the length of the force of gravity arrow, and the length of the force of tension initial arrow equals just the length of the force of gravity arrow.
Exactly, Bo. Nice. And the change in the force of tension measurement when I lower the steel sphere into the water equals the force of tension final minus the force of tension initial. Substituting in the equations we got for those two forces of tension gives us the force of gravity minus the buoyant force, minus the force of gravity, or just the negative of the buoyant force. In other words, the change in the force of tension measurement when I lower the steel sphere into the water is the negative of the buoyant force.
That is what I said, right?
Correct, Bo, but I showed the math for it and I showed it was negative.
Yeah, right.
That means when I zero the force sensor, which is attached to the string holding up the steel sphere, and then lower the steel sphere into the water, the force sensor should read negative 0.67 newtons after I lower the steel sphere into the water. And will you look at that? It almost does.
What?
0.68 newtons is pretty close to 0.67 newtons.
And it's actually alternating between 0.67 and 0.68 newtons, so it's probably close to 0.675 newtons.
We forgot about the string.
Right.
Yeah. The string displaces a very small amount of water and has a very small buoyant force acting on it, which increases the measured buoyant force by a small amount.
Yeah.
But why not use 3 sig figs?
Yeah.
That is a fair question. The force sensor is not very accurate past the 100th place during this measurement.
Okay.
Let's do this again, only now, notice there is also a force sensor under the beaker of water. And then, again, let's zero both force sensors. When I lower the sphere into the water, what do you think will happen to the reading of the force sensor under the beaker?
Will the steel sphere touch the bottom of the beaker?
Nope. I'm going to do exactly what I did before. The steel sphere will be submerged in the water and held up by the string.
Then the force reading on the force sensor holding up the beaker in water should just stay at zero, right?
I guess so.
Maybe.
Okay, let's see what happens. And you can see the new force sensor measurement is 0.68 newtons, the same magnitude as the buoyant force.
What?
Right. Can one of you explain why?
Not me.
It has to do with Newton's third law.
Oh, right. Every force is an interaction between two objects.
Right. The buoyant force that acts on the sphere acts upward from the water on the sphere.
And Newton's third law states that there must be an equal but opposite force to that upward buoyant force.
In other words, there is also an equal but opposite downward buoyant force which acts from the sphere on the water.
So when you lower the sphere into the water, a buoyant force of 0.68 newtons acts down from the sphere on the water and increases the measurement of the force sensor holding up the beaker by 0.68 newtons.
Cool.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But I am not done.
No awesome. Way.
There's more?
Yes, there is. With the steel sphere in the water, let's mark the volume of the water in the beaker. Then let's take this steel sphere out of the water. And then let's add water again until the water level is back to where it was with the steel sphere in the water.
Wait, the force sensor measurement went back to 0.68 newtons.
Why?
Because the buoyant force equals the weight of the fluid displaced by an object.
Whoa.
So adding 0.68 newtons of water brings the water level back to exactly where it was when the steel sphere was in the water.
Exactly. The buoyant force equals the mass of the fluid displaced by the water times the gravitational field strength. In other words, with the steel sphere in the water, there is a buoyant force acting downward on the water, which is equal to the force of gravity that would act on water, which would fill the spherical space where the steel sphere is. Okay.
Huh?
By adding water to the beaker such that the water level is at the same height as when the steel sphere was in the water, we have added a volume of water which equals the volume of the steel sphere and the volume of the fluid displaced by the steel sphere. And when we multiply that volume of water by the density of water, we get the mass of the water we added to the beaker. But that is also the mass of the fluid displaced by the steel sphere. And the force of gravity and buoyant force both equal that mass times the gravitational field strength. The weight of the water we added to the beaker is the same as the weight of the fluid displaced by the steel sphere. That is why the force sensor measurement is the same in these two situations.
Cool.
Okay, that makes sense.
Sure. But why did we never use the density of steel in any of our calculations?
Yeah. Why is that?
Because the only thing we calculated was the buoyant force, and the buoyant force does not change based on which object is displacing the fluid. The buoyant force only changes based on the density of the fluid displaced by the object and the volume of the fluid displaced.
Okay, yeah, I got it. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Yeah, thanks.
Well done, everybody. I do want to take a moment to look at this in terms of pressure as well. Remember, pressure equals force perpendicular to the surface divided by area. The force from the water pushes down on the bottom of the beaker, so that force is perpendicular to the bottom surface of the beaker. That means we can drop the perpendicular subscript from the force and rearrange that equation to get force equals pressure times area. And we know the pressure at the bottom of the fluid, which is called gauge pressure, equals rho, the density of the fluid, times g, the gravitational field strength, times h, the depth of the fluid. So the force measured by the sensor equals the density of the fluid times gravitational field strength times fluid depth times the cross-sectional area of the beaker. But because I have zeroed out the force sensor with the beaker on it before we add the steel sphere or the extra water, what we are measuring when I add the steel sphere or the water is the change in force, or force final minus force initial. And when we can substitute the equation I just found for the force using final and initial subscripts for h, the depth of the water, we can factor out the density of the fluid, gravitational field strength, and cross-sectional area. And depth final minus depth initial equals the change in depth of the water.
Oh, and because the density, gravitational field, and cross-sectional area of the beaker are constants, and the change in depth of the water is the same for both the beaker with the steel sphere and the beaker with the added water, the change in the force measurement is the same in both instances.
Cool.
Yeah, but also the area of the base times height equals volume. So the cross-sectional area times the change in depth equals the change in volume of the water. And the density of the water times the change in volume of the water equals the mass of the fluid you added to the beaker after taking the steel sphere out. And because density times volume equals mass, the mass of the water you added to the beaker is the same as the mass of the water displaced by the object. And that mass times the gravitational field strength equals the buoyant force acting on the steel sphere. We just proved, this time using pressure, that the change in the force measurement of the force sensor equals the buoyant force acting on the steel sphere.
Whoa.
And it equals the weight of the volume of water added to the beaker after we removed the steel sphere.
Yeah, that is cool.
Hold up.
What?
We never said it.
What? Really?
I think we need to because, you know, it did.
Yeah.
Yep.
The physics works. The physics works. The physics works. The physics works. The physics works.
Absolutely. Thanks for the help, and thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.